Hello.
Hello.
I'm Rosie and Miss Hebden.
I'd like to show you someone.
Okay, well come on in. We're here. Hello.
This is my grandpa. His name is Herbert Altschuler. He's here to talk about World War II. He was actually there.
But that's not, I wasn't invited to talk to World War II. I was invited to talk the time under the Nazis. Now, I was born in S-P-E-Y-E-R, Speyer on the Rhine River, 1918. End of World War I, I was born, Germany. My father was in the German Army, he was an officer in the German Army, and wounded and seen action. He was an engineer building pontoon. You know what a pontoon is? It's a bridge over boats, they call it pontoon. He was an engineer, but that's beside the point. We lived in Czechoslovakia, what used to be Czechoslovakia, now it's the Czech Republic because Slovakia went away, they separated, the Czech Republic. And I used to live in the Sudetenland. Does everybody know what the Sudetenland was?
Yes, sir.
What was the Sudetenland?
It's where the Germans
lived. It's right. See, after World War I, the Germans lost the war, took territory away from Germany. And that treated Germany as a loser. In World War II, we gave the Marshall Plan, we gave Germany and Japan, we rebuilt them, just the opposite. After World War I, they took away from Germany. And Germany had a very bad time. That's the way Hitler came out of it. The president of Germany used to be Hindenburg, who was a hero in World War I. But he was an old man and senile, and he's the one who brought Hitler into the regime. Actually, Hitler wasn't elected, he was brought in by Hindenburg, you know. And Hitler and the Nazis, the National Socialist Party, and because everybody was in bad shape, and Hitler promised them a wonderful future. And that's the reason they went along with Hitler, with the Nazis. Now, the Nazi was anti-Semites. You know what anti-Semite is?
Yeah.
Against the Jews. They were against others too. They were against the Gypsies. They were against the Communists. They were against anybody who was a danger to Hitler was the enemy. But I'm talking about the Jewish question. I'm Jewish myself. And the Kristallnacht. Everybody know what the Kristallnacht was?
Yeah.
The night of broken glass. That's when the Nazis started to arrest the man Jewish and put them away in camps. And the 2nd of November, we just had the anniversary of the Kristallnacht. I wasn't in Germany. I lived in Sudetenland, in the German part of Czechoslovakia. The Sudeten were the mountains which separated Germany and Czechoslovakia. The mountains. I used to go skiing there. And the Germans, the people who lived there talked German. We had to learn Czech in school, which was very difficult for German to learn. But we had to learn in school because it was the Czech government. It was a very democratic government, the Czech government. But the Germans who lived there in Sudetenland, they were more Germans by heart, and they didn't like the Czechs too much. It was democracy. They were in the government. Everybody was represented. And every nationality who lived there was represented in the government. When Hitler came, he called it liberation. When they took over, just like Alsace-Lorraine was part of France, also from Germany. Austria, he liberated too. he said, because I spoke German, it's part of Germany. So he said he only gonna take over places which were part of Germany. That's what he said. But in Munich is in German München, they had a meeting because the world seen what was going on, what Hitler did. So they wanted to talk to Hitler. Chamberlain, he was the Prime Minister of England, the Prime Minister of France, in Italy, Mussolini, they went to see Hitler. Hitler told him, don't worry, I only want to take what belonged to Germany, the territory which belonged to Germany, I want to take back. That's all I want. They believed him. And Chamberlain came back to London and said, peace in our time. But everybody believed Hitler, and nobody opposed him. So he just kept going, they called it the Blitzkrieg, Lightning War, Blitzkrieg, and he took over the rest of Europe. He went to take over Poland, September the 1st, 1939, he invaded Poland. Now, I lived 3 years in Prague, which is the capital of Czechoslovakia, Praha, Prague. I worked for a Czech outfit. I wanted to better my language. I wanted to live there. And I worked 3 years, and my brother was 2 years young, and he also lived there. I worked for a shoe company. It wasn't Patria, but there was the famous shoe company. It was a shoe company. And my father and mother, they stayed in Sudetenland. The place where we lived in Sudetenland name was Carlsbad, like the Carlsbad in California, Carlsbad. It was a famous spa. They had hot geysers. People from all over the world used to go to drink that this water, this geyser water, and I used to live there. Now my father worked for New York, an American company for Macy's. My father worked for Macy's in New York, which was owned by the Strausses, and we were distant related to the Strausses. Now my father's job was to import fine china and crystal glass to the United States. Czechoslovakia was famous for the fine china, and also for the lampshade. Crystal glass, that's what my father's job was. He used to come to the United States at least once a year. He used to come here to talk to his boss. So my father talked English perfect. My mother also used to talk English and French perfect. And German, they all talk German, of course. I was 20 years old when I came here, so my basic education was over there. I used it as an excuse of my accent. It's not an excuse, but I just didn't lose my accent, unfortunately, okay? Because I was here since 1939. But I know I'm not ashamed because the governor of California also has an accent. Not apparently, but he has an accent. He came from Austria. My mother and father were in Karlsbad when the Nazis marched in. And we found out in Prague, we found out from the radio that the Nazis occupied Czechoslovakia, I mean the Sudetenland, like I told you, the Sudetenland. Part of Germany, they took from Germany. And before they knew it, we called my mother and father on the phone and said, come quick to Prague, because the Nazis are coming into Sudetenland. So they left everything behind, and they came to Prague. Now, after a little while, my father had a crazy idea to go back to Karlsbad to try to get some of his things he owned. He had a wonderful stamp collection, which he had from his grandfather yet, and he was a little stamp collector. You know, his watermarks and the teas and everything. Beautiful collection. That's the first thing they took. He thought he could take it, go back and take it. We told him not to go. But my father was his German officer. He wouldn't take, he was the boss. Whatever he said, when my mother said to me anything. So they bought, my mother went along. My mother thought it was a bad idea, but she went along with him and they went back to Karlsbad. As soon as they got to the station, the railroad station there, the Gestapo were waiting for them. The Gestapo is the German Geheimpolizei, the, you know,
the secret police.
Secret police. And they were waiting for them. They knew he's coming back and he couldn't even get in our home. They were waiting for him, put him in jail. And my father was 20 years older than my mother. And the people in jail there, in charge of the jail, they were told my, they said to my, they thought my mother wasn't Jewish because she didn't look Jewish. And she said, why don't you get rid of this old man? Divorce him, get rid of him. He says, no. They wouldn't take her out of jail if she would have said yes, but she said no. So the boys were in jail. But my brother and I, we went. We had good friends in Karlsbad. I used to go to the gymnasium, which is, everybody knows what a gymnasium is?
Mm-hmm. It's like it's a high school.
High school and college. 4 years in high school, 4 years of high school and 4 years of college. And then you take a big examination, what they call the matura. And we know the professor from gymnasium, which was my friend, and they all talked to the Nazis. And they were able to get my mother and father out of jail. But my father had to sign to never go back in German territory, to leave everything behind, everything owned, to leave behind, and never go back in German territory. So when Germany invaded the rest of Czechoslovakia, my father was in German territory, because they came after, you know, they invited, the rest of took the whole Czechoslovakia, you know. And so, and we had the, you know, everybody knows what the Irby David is. In order to go to the United States, you had to have an Irby David. That's the only way you could come here. Irby David, somebody has to leave money in the bank. I don't know how much. Money in the bank, so in case when you're here, if you need money, don't ask the government, you go and get the money from the bank. And you had to know somebody in the U.S. in order to get an Irby David. And not everybody was lucky enough. But we were lucky enough to get an Irby David, but we had to wait for the visa. And it depends how many people lived in different countries, Hungary and Poland, different countries. It depends how long you had to wait for the visa. While we were waiting, see, in order to get out of occupied Germany, you know, Czechoslovakia, you had to, your passport had to be signed by the Nazis. There was a big J in your passport, which means you were Jew. Big J, they knew when you opened up the passport you were Jewish. We had to get their permission from the Gestapo to get out of there.
Oh. Do you still have your visa?
No.
Your passport?
No. So you had to get a visa, and my brother and I, we were standing in line for many, many hours during the night, and every time we got to the office from the Gestapo, they said that you have to wait. You waited. I don't know how many days. But finally the letters got to go to the office of Gestapo. And they put the okay in the passport to be able to leave. But in the meantime, while we were in Czechoslovakia, we had to go in hiding because, remember I said my father had to say he never go back into Germany,
yes.
And Germany came after us, so therefore we went into hiding. We went to a farm and then somewhere hidden. And my brother and I were in one room, my mother and father were in the other room. We expected the Gestapo to come. They come during the night time. And look, they were looking for people who left to Sudetenland, like my father did. So then, luckily, they knocked on our door where my brother and I were, and they asked us, how long are you here? And we said, we're here 3 years, which was true. Who's in the other room? I said, my mother and my father. How long are they here? I said, the same time, which was a lie. But they said, I expected Gestapo to come, so I wasn't upset. I said, very, you know, when they see you nervous, then they're thinking something wrong. And I wasn't nervous because I knew they were gonna come. I said, you want to meet them? That's not necessary. I said, I knocked on my mother and father's door. My father came out middle of the night. And I said, Pop, that's the Gestapo and this is my father. My father's face was white. I thought he was gonna pass out. But the Gestapo says, okay, fine, goodbye. And afterwards, my father gave me hell and said, what are you doing? You introduced me to Gestapo. I said, Pop, I just saved your life. I just saved your life. So, all we had made the reservation on the Georgic, it was Kundalein, White Star, British boat, to go to the United States. First, we went on the last train, which took Jews out. The last two cars were Jews in there. When we got to Aachen, everybody knows what Aachen is? Mm. It's a border town between Belgium and Germany. In Aachen, there's a border. The Germans said the last two cars were Jews. Everybody had to leave and get out of the car because they want to inspect the car with anybody smuggled jewelry or anything which wasn't allowed. They wanted to check it. So everybody would leave. I left too. And I left our blanket in there. My father says, Herbert, go back and get a blanket. I didn't listen to Gestapo, I listened to my father. I was used to take orders from him, you know. So I go back and this tall German hit me on the head and said, didn't I tell you you should get out of here? So he took me in a separate room and stripped me, okay, when they searched me. So I had a medal in my pocket. I used to be active in Prague with the Jewish Athletic Club. I used to run middle distance. I used to be pretty good. It's a medal I had from cross country, I think. And he looked at it and he said, what's this? I said, it's a medal I won in the running. He said, you Jew, you're an athlete? I said, yes. You wouldn't believe it. I says, here's a medal, here's my name on it. Can I have it? I says, go ahead. And after that, he talked to me like I was a fellow Nazi. It was so nice, you know? The majority of Germans, the ones that didn't live as Jews, they believed this propaganda the German had against Jews. Goebbels, he was one of the propaganda chiefs. They had pictures in the Germans forced the Czechs to put this caricature pictures in the store windows where they showed Jews with long noses and with money back. And that was a propaganda. They were trying to get the Czechs against the Jews. But the Czechs, see, we lived there, we didn't live separately. We lived together with the Catholic, didn't make any religion work. We had friends with everybody. The Czechs were very democratic like that. So a lot of these Germans, they believed this propaganda and they had the Jews. And we went to school there as small kids. We were the only, my brother and I were the only Jewish boys in the school, and they used to beat us up here. They used to say, you're responsible for our crucifixion of our God, they used to say. It was before the Germans were in, but in Sudetenland. They were teaching the kids that the Jews were responsible for the crucifixion, which was a lie. The Polish Pope, I heard it was Pope Paul, he told the people that it's not true that the Jews are responsible for the crucifixion, because he was living in Poland when the Germans were there, when the Italians were there, and he knew the truth, and he made it public. I don't know whether they blamed the United States, the Jews, for the crucifixion in school, I don't know. But that's what it incidentally, you know? So you know this was before the Germans went there, they already had, you know, blamed the Jews for a lot of things. Not the Czechs, the Germans. So when we finally got the United States, was September the 1st, 1939. That's when Germany went into Poland. It's when the war started. That's when I got here. When I got here, it wasn't easy because we got here in suitcase. My father lost everything. My father was well off because he used to get paid in dollars. At that time, the dollar wasn't like it's now. Way down, it was high up. He used to get a lot of money for the dollars. 30 Czech crowns you got for the dollar. You could live 3 days, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, in the best hotels for $1. That's how much the dollar was worth. And my father used to get paid in dollars, therefore we were pretty well off. But unfortunately, he put all his savings in the German banks. Because my father's brother and sister, they lived in Germany. They had the store there and took the money. But they all were killed. My uncle and my aunt, most of my relatives got killed. Now, you learned about the concentration camps? You know what was going on there?
Yes.
The people who said concentration camp never happened. Iran, the president, the leader of Iran said something like that. Patton, General Patton, in Eisenhower, they went to liberate the concentration camps. When they seen the skeletons, the only were skeletons, the people who still were alive looked like a bunch of skeletons. They were crying. Tough guys like Patton. I met Patton. Yeah, but can you imagine what kind? How they looked like, the ones who survived? From 6 million, the GIs felt sorry for them, and many of them gave a lot of food in their blood because they couldn't digest their food anymore. So, I really didn't live in Germany, but that's what happened. Anybody has any questions?
Okay. Well, let's raise your hand and be patient, okay? And try to raise your voice, okay? So, Gabe.
When you dealt with the Germans or the Gestapo, were they mean or rude to you, or did they treat you?
Well, the ones I talked to were not nice. But when they found out that I'm an athlete, they changed. Because their propaganda taught them that Jews, not athletes, they're only out to make money. They didn't know what a Jew was. He was so surprised that he treated me nice. He said to me, "Where are you going?" I said, "United States." "Don't talk bad about us." That's what he thought. I said, "No, don't worry about it." Any more questions?
Allie?
Under what circumstances did you meet General Patton?
Oh, well, I was 4 years in the service and 2 years overseas. I was in North Africa, Sicily, and Italy. And we were near in southern Italy. And near Naples. I was in Naples, Napoli. I was in the Rome. Now I went on a pass in Rome. And he was there. And I didn't know him personally. I know that there weren't many in Italy that like classic music and have beautiful music. He had one orchestra left there, and they made a special concert when Patton was there. And different pieces from different countries, Russian pieces. The last piece was a Russian piece. They had a big iron pipe hanging there, an old man found the pipe. I never could find out. What happened until the last piece, and it hit the pipe because the piece was about a communist music, about the steel mill. But that's the only time I've seen him. And when he went through the street, he's in his command car, the siren was blown. But I know that some people didn't think much nice of him because something happened in the hospital, patient, he figured the patient is just, you know, sometimes it's just, nothing is wrong with them, they want to get out of the service. So he thought this one person, that's the reason he had a bad name. But he was a wonderful general, he went with his men in a tank, and they went so fast. They had to be supplied, the gasoline supplied from an airplane. And I think it was one of the reasons he wanted the war. And he didn't die in action. He died after the war in Paris in the automobile accident. But he was a great general, a soldier's general.
Irene?
Why did you join the Air Force?
They just assigned me to the Air Force. But when they asked me questions, every soldier, to make a record, you know, what they can do and everything. And I wrote down that I can speak German, perfect, Czech, and some English. And because I could type 60 words a minute, they made me a typist. I mean, they did things like that. They used to take cooks, they took truck drivers and made cooks out of them. That's what the food tasted from truck drivers and cooks, you know. That's what it's in the service, you know. But when we got the neighbors, we were stationed near neighbors, the big palace, like the Palace of Versailles, was the headquarters of Allied Air Forces. The General Ira Aker, he was the general over all the Mediterranean, you know. And I went to them, I told them, I speak languages. I said, all I do is type. He says, we need you. So I was in the A4, which was supply. I asked my officer, said, can you transfer me? He was a West Pointer. He says, no. So I went back to the intelligence and says, don't worry, we get you transferred. So I got transferred in intelligence. I was a PFC. So they made me a sergeant. But I actually did officer's work. If they would have classified me as an officer in the States, I could have went to school and I could have had a commission. This way they made me a sergeant. But at least I did important work, not just typing. I did very important work. You want to know what I did? The prison camp we had where German prisoners were. In the last year of the war, the Germans were short on manpower and they drafted Czechs into the German army. And these Czechs were working as slave labor before, and they went underground because we bombed Ploesti. Have anybody heard about Ploesti? Oil fields. We bombed there and destroyed all the oil fields, and that's where Germany got most of the oil from Ploesti. And they came with the German army, and they came over to us. They ran away and let them take themselves prisoner. So they came over to us and they wanted to fight. British had German legion, they had the Jewish legion, they had different Polish legion. They wanted to fight for us, for the British. So I went to prison camps and I knew in some of them were Sudeten Germans, you know, and they went as Czechs because, and they wanted to come over to as spies, the Sudeten Germans. And I could separate them because I could tell who were the real Czechs and who were the Germans, because German and Czech is so different. When you live there, you can tell from the accent whether they're Germans or Czechs. So I used to separate them. I put the Germans back in a prison and I left the Czechs to come over and fight for us. I think this was an important thing. I could do it because I used to live there. And then I also interviewed, I asked the Czechs who the Germans used. The Germans went underground because they were bombed. They went underground where they built things. And this slave labor, I asked him, near what is a mountain, near what river, I asked him where they lived, where they worked, and did the work for the Germans. And I made the reports. And we have planes and made pictures over the Germany. And they took my reports and matched it up with the pictures to find places where they can bomb them, where they have the industry. That's another thing I did. So I did important work.
Any other questions? Sean?
My question is, which invasions during the war were you involved in, like German-Poland invasion?
We went North Africa first, and then Sicily and then Italy. In North Africa, we already, in fact, the Germans left already. North Africa. We could see all these burned out tanks in the desert, what the Germans left behind. But we got there in April, 1943, and they already left. We were stationed north, out in the desert. We were stationed, we had our tent out in the desert. And then we went to Sicily, Palermo, that is also after the invasion. The things in Italy, things were very, very bad. Houses were damaged. People, the mothers in Sicily were pimping the GIs to make a few dollars. It was a terrible situation.
Do you remember what you brought to America in your suitcase?
Some of our clothes. Can't get much, four people in one suitcase. We lived in 52nd Eden of Philadelphia. One room, and my father was already now 60, he was 16. He couldn't get a job in 39, it still was very bad there. My brother and I, we took any job we could get, any. After the war, I was lucky. On the GI Bill, I went to school.
Can you tell us about your brother's tuxedo?
Yeah, tuxedo. He brought a tuxedo along, and they wanted to know what for. And he said, he got rich relatives in the United States, and if he has a visit, so, but he had to work for a tuxedo. They all used to think the United States is like the money flows on the street. They thought everybody's a millionaire. Yeah?
When you first seen the swastika, did you know that there was trouble ahead? Or were you scared?
I knew about the Nazis.
Oh, you knew about them?
Yeah. See, the United States is far away, but there, Czechoslovakia was next to Germany and Austria. We knew everything was going on. You know? Well, I didn't know anything about concentration camp until the Nazis got together, I don't even remember where it was, and made a decision what they're going to do with the Jews. So they decided to destroy them.
Tell them the story about the, didn't you write a letter to Grandma about where you were and you couldn't tell her where you were and you said about a movie? What was that?
We landed in Casablanca, North Africa. No, we weren't allowed to write home where we are. We had numbers. I got a letter from my mother where she said she'd seen a wonderful movie, Casablanca. So I sent her back and I said, Mom, I have that same movie right here, so she knew I was in Casablanca. And my brother was in North Africa and I didn't know it. We both were got in the same time. My brother didn't know I was in North Africa and I hitchhiked where he was. He was in the hospital. He cut his hand. You know what the sea ration can is? He fell on a sea ration can and cut his hand. And he wrote a letter to me, and I come walking in. He didn't know I was there. So he seen I was there.
Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you so much.
I enjoyed you. I like to see young, happy faces. I'm 91 years old. I appreciate you inviting me and your teachers. I appreciate it. So, that's all I can say.